go with me in your Bibles this morning. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. In our time of worshiping the Lord through the Word today, we will bring our study in the fourth chapter of Paul's first letter to Timothy to a close. And again, I encourage you to take your bulletin or whatever you use for note-taking. And I want you to be ready to take down and the six characteristics that we're going to see of the good ministry, of the good faithful servant, and what Paul gives to contrast with the false teacher in this chapter. And I can't help but think, but 10 years ago, a decade has gone by. 10 years ago, right in this season, and Ginger and I were searching what is God's will for our lives. And I remember visiting churches and being in the area. We lived in Centerline, and we were prayerfully considering, Lord, what is your plan? All my plans were gone. All the things that I thought, the churches that I knew of, that I knew people in the churches, and I thought, that's going to work out, and this will work out. It was all just, you know, in the trash can, and all we had was the Lord. And He's enough. He's enough. And I remember going to churches. There was one particular church I went to. It wasn't warm like it is today. And it was a large church. And I think it was Christmas Sunday. And Ginger had gone down to Kentucky. I was by myself. I had to work. And so we caught up later. And I was in a church. And they did the, all right, turn around and welcome one another. And I'm by myself. It was everything I could do to just, I got to get to church today. I'm not going to stay home. I'm going to go, even though my family's not here. I don't like living single, you know. So I came in a little late. My hands were cold, hung my coat up. All right, everybody, welcome one another. I'm like, oh, great. I didn't know that was coming. My hand, some of you, I've shaken your hand. My hands are just ice cold. And I'm like, okay, you know, hi, good morning. And I shake a couple hands, and their hand is warm, my hand's cold. And I shake, I reach my hand out to one lady. I don't know how old she was. She was older than I am. Shook her hand. Oh, his hand is cold. His hand is cold. And I'm like, I was like Kmart Blue Light Special. This is the guy. And I'm like, oh, Lord. Please, answer prayer. And not long after that, he showed himself to say, I know exactly where you're supposed to be. And can you believe 10 years? How quickly 10 years go by. And that's, wow. But God's leading in our lives. He's been faithful. God's leading this congregation, because this congregation was at that point saying, all right, Lord, who is the one that you will bring to us to lead? And so there was prayer taking place on all sides. Now we're in this Christmas season, and I understand there's mixed feelings, there's mixed realities with holidays, holy days, those days that are meant for joy. And then we get this image, we get this package of what Christmas is supposed to be, and Christmas time and Christmas spirit, and you know, whatever that is conjured up, we have to have our spiritual lenses wiped away and say, what is Christmas time all about? What is the message? It's the gospel. It's the good news. We have sung of it this morning, that Christ came as a baby to die. So, you know, even the world mocks the movie, you know, Baby Jesus, the Christmas Baby Jesus, Dear Baby Jesus. Why? Because they like that version of Jesus. Because you can do what you want to with an infant. But this God who became a man, this is the message. This is the gospel message. So the world uses the Christmas message, Christmas time and Christmas spirit. They use the message that works for them because it sells. And they try to involve it into holidays. Right, let's just go with the holidays. The empty, we don't want to be controversial, you know, manger scenes or anything like that. Let's just go with holidays. But we still need the Christmas holiday because that's when we pay the bills. To the believer, to the child of God, we don't have a message that sells. We have a message that saves. That's why this is important to us. That's why Easter is important to us. That's why false religions try to obscure and twist and contort. You shouldn't celebrate the pagan holiday. We're not celebrating a pagan holiday. We're celebrating Emmanuel. We're celebrating God with us. And he was born and he lived a sinless life and he died in the place of sinners and he didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead. So we will celebrate Christmas and we will celebrate Easter because Jesus lives and he reigns and he's the King of Kings and he is the Lord of Lords. So if we are entrusted with this message, we better get it right. Okay, if there is one message that saves, then we better know that message. And I pray that you've embraced the gospel. And if you have embraced the gospel, then God is changing you and he's changing me through the gospel. And we have to know what is true and we have to know what is false. Or let's be honest. Are there other messages that save? Maybe there are churches that save, or there are works-based religions that all lead to heaven. Are there really? Because you can't have it both ways. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So we're not saying the same thing. We can all be wrong, but we can't all be right. Scripture says there's only one way to God. It's through Jesus Christ and him alone, not Jesus in the Baptist church. Or any other church, or anything you can do, or anything I can do. We can't earn our way into God's family, just like a child cannot earn their way into a family and say, you will adopt me now because I mowed your yard, and I washed your car, and I did all these things for you. Now you owe me adoption. It's unthinkable. All the praise for a parent who adopts a child, it's not to the child. No praise to the child. It's all to the parents who opened up their home and gave that child equal standing with their natural born children. You are ours. You bear our name. Now welcome to the family. Now you're part of the family and live out the grace that has been demonstrated to you. It's a huge difference. It's all the difference in time and eternity. So the angels came. They proclaimed this message 2,000 years ago. They came to shepherds. And the shepherds went and they saw. They didn't miss it. They didn't miss Christmas. And they went and what did they do? They told everybody. How many people listen? Shepherds? A little too much juice out there on the hillside, shepherd? Whatever. And how many people will not listen to you? But it doesn't matter. Be faithful and know the message. That's why this is in contrast. That's why we have to understand the gospel. Because there are false teachers. And that's what Paul deals with in the first five verses. There are people wanting to sell you a line of goods. Because it works out really good for them now, bad for eternity. And if you buy into it, it works out really good for them now. And it all ends up in a sham, in a false gospel that doesn't save, so it is no gospel at all. And it lands how many millions of people in eternal separation from God because they trusted in themselves. They trusted in what someone religious told them instead of in what does the Bible say? What does the Word of God say? So it matters. We looked last week at the good minister, the characteristics of the good minister. I'll just go through these briefly. He instructs the brethren in the truth in verse 6. He is well nourished in the truth. And he practices what he preaches. He rejects foolish myths and wives' tales. He trains himself in godliness. He's a hard worker. He's willing to suffer reproach. And he teaches the scripture with authority. And Paul ends that section with these things. Command and teach. Timothy, I'm giving you the message. I'm giving you your ministry. Here it is. Take heed. You have to take care of you, Timothy, before you go shepherd anybody else. But now here's the deal. It doesn't stop with you. So you're not going to go be a monk, and you're not going to go live up in the hillside somewhere and just fast and diet and pray and study and meditate. No, your life is to hit the people. It's to make a difference in the lives of people. The spiritual gifts that God has given to you, it's not for you, Timothy. He's going to use you for other people, for his people, to strengthen the believers and to evangelize those who are non-believers so that they can come to faith in Christ. Save the lost, strengthen the saved. That's how your life is going to be used, Timothy. So what then does this good ministry look like? We're here to look in your Bible, and I trust that you have a copy of the Word of God there before you. Verse 12, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by the prophecy, with the laying on of hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Let's pray. Father, again, I admit I need you. You have to take your word through your servant by your spirit, and you have to apply it to the hearts of the hearers today. And change us by your word, Lord. Let us see Christ. Oh, the reality is Timothy wasn't sufficient for these things on his own. I'm not sufficient for these things. There's no man on this planet that is sufficient for these things unless our sufficiency comes from you. And then we not only can, by the power of the Holy Spirit, deliver your word, but we must. And we will. So I pray not only for this time of worship here, but for our brothers and sisters around the world who will stand and gather today under your word. May those who deliver your word, Lord, help those men to preach the word in faithfulness. Build your church, Lord. Let your will be done and your kingdom come. For Jesus' sake, amen. This morning, the good ministry. All right, we're going to look at this. Paul describes the good ministry. All right, the good ministry, if you take this chapter in the three sections that I've broken it up in here, today we're looking at the good ministry. Last week we saw the good minister, the good servant, and it stands in stark contrast to the profile of the false teacher. So here's what's false. Here's the contrast, Timothy. This is what you are supposed to do, and this is where it plays out. This is what it looks like. And it's very different than where false teachers and everything derives around them, and it's selfish and it's self-centered and a false righteousness. No, that's not to be you, and here's what you do with it. All right? That's what we're seeing. So six instructions for the servant of God to embrace for the good ministry. All right? So six characteristics, six instructions for the servant of God to embrace for the good ministry. Timothy, you got to embrace these. You got to understand these. Brian, you got to understand these. You got to embrace these. Young men, middle-aged men that God may call to ministry, here you go. You're seeing what ministry is, so get it. And I'm praying that God does a work. And we have young men say, here I am, like Isaiah, send me. You take that cleansing coal and you purify my lips. You use my lips to proclaim your praise. So number one, Timothy, be a good example. We see that in verse 12. Be a good example. Paul's the one that wrote to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11:1, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Follow me as I follow Christ. So Paul says to him, let no one despise your youth. Don't let anyone think around you because of your age. So we need to take a closer look at this word, despise. The Greek word is kataphroneo. Okay, it means to look down on. And in the common usage of the Greek language in the first century, kataphroneo was used of showing contempt or disregard for somebody or something. Now, when they translated the Old Testament from the Hebrew into the Greek, that's the Septuagint, they use this word, katafroneo. It usually renders buzz and bizarre. Objects of contempt include, in the Old Testament, where this word is used, God in Hosea 6:7, despising or contempt for one's father, Genesis 27:12, contempt despising one's mother, Proverbs 23:22, despising, looking down on the ways of the law, Proverbs 19 and verse 16. So all of those above usages of katafroneo, it demonstrates extreme disrespect toward God, His word, and figures of authority. Okay, so get the background, the understanding of this word. Objects that should be honored are dishonored, despised. Now in the New Testament, this word, katafroneo, is found 9 times. Jesus used the word in his teaching about the impossibility of serving 2 masters. Can't do it. You can't serve God and money. You're going to love one, hate the other. You're going to despise one. Okay, you can't look up on both. You have to either look up and worship God, or you look up and you worship materialism. You can't do both. So if I worship my banking account and my wealth and my portfolio, I'm despising God. It's like a teeter-totter. You can't have it both up. But if I worship God, then I despise, I'm looking down. I'm showing contempt toward money. Money, I just use money to bless and bless people, pay the bills, provide and be a blessing to others. In Hebrews 12 and verse 2, the word is used in a positive sense when the writer states, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising, there it is, the shame. So Christ looked at the end goal, glorifying the Father, redeeming lost souls, and he looked down on the cross. Despising the shame, all of that, he counted the glory of God, the redemption of souls. That's to be honored. That's to be highly esteemed. It is used in a bad sense when Jesus warns against the serious offense of despising his little ones in Matthew 18:10. Don't you look down on children or new believers. Can I just take a moment to say, we are in need of those to come alongside of Corey Tong and Daria Fisher and say, I will serve and invest my life in the children's ministry. It's such a quiet service. But what does Jesus do when all the loud and proud disciples are around? He says, excuse me, bring a kid. You want to be something? Serve the ones who are nothings in the world. Serve them. Invest your life. Yeah, you know, they might get snot on my leg. Can you do that for the glory of God? Jesus warns against that. It's also used in a negative sense when Paul warns against Romans 2:4, despising God's kindness. There are so many who think, you know, well, if God was really powerful, then how does he let this bad thing happen? And how does he let that bad thing happen? And if God is really good, then why do people suffer? And all of those questions. You know what that is? That's despising God's kindness. That he has left that person alive one more day and given them one more breath for them to judge him, blaspheme him, question him, the one that gives them life. Do you despise? Do you think? Do you belittle? You look down? You're condescending on God's kindness? Do you not know that it's his mercy that brings you to repentance? You need a volcano to come up in your backyard and a message that comes out in lava form saying repent? You wouldn't repent. You would say, see, God is angry. Therefore, I'm not going to serve him. How did he show his love? He came as Christ, as a baby. He took to himself flesh. He hung and died. And you spit on him. If you're really the Son of God, come down and save us. Save yourself. You saved other people, save yourself. No, he died to save all who would trust in him. Do you despise that? Do you look down on that? Katafroneo. Despising God's church, 1 Corinthians 11:22. They're in the context of the Lord's table. despising here in 1 Timothy 4:12, youthful leaders. And we're going to come to it in 1 Timothy 6, verse 2, the Christian masters of slaves, that a Christian slave who has a Christian master would despise them and say, you're really a Christian. You should let me go. You should just forgive my earthly debt and let me go. So that's the word. Displays of individuals and groups who publicly despise, think about this in the world we live in. Do you not see it on the news often now? Where people are so emboldened that they can stand toe-to-toe with police officers and curse them and curse them and curse them and despise them, and children despise their parents and say horrible things to their parents. Wisconsin, they go in and sit in the Capitol building in Madison. Where's the respect, right? Where is the... No, we live in a world that people do whatever they want to do. University campuses, give us safe space, and we want our faculty and administration, we want them gone. Every man did that which is right in his own eyes. It's not right. J.I. Packer, he writes this. In the New Testament, as in the Septuagint, the common use of this word group is in context, dealing with a lack of respect due for the words, works, ministers, and people of God. Sadly, are you shocked when non-believers stand off against police officers and curse them and blaspheme them and just utter vile, horrible things at them? Does that really surprise you? Does it really surprise you that we have indoctrinated a nation now, there is no God, and you came from ooze, and you go nowhere? Are you really surprised that non-believing students gather in common areas on campuses and speak atrocities to those who are the leadership of the campus? Or does that surprise you? No. You know what does surprise me is when that happens in the church. And men and women don't use their words, their minds, and their lives to say, you are despising the leadership that God has given. Are you not afraid that you could die, your heart stop, and you stand before God, and those are your last words of, well, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Timothy, don't let no one despise you. You may be young, but you've been given a God-given task, and you need to fulfill your ministry, and you can't do it in the back room alone. You have to take what you've learned and studied and prayed over in the back room, and you have to bring it to bear on the people of God and on the non-believers as well in evangelism. We're not all going to get along. There is truth and there is error. So Timothy, warm up, step up to the plate, and swing for the fences with the truth. Whether people like it, whether people like you or they don't, doesn't matter. God is watching. God is sovereign. And God will judge all. So be faithful. The man of God must set an example. Must set an example. And the word here in the Greek is tupos. It's a type. It's a godly pattern. How is Timothy to set an example? In word. Paul says in word, and that's your conversation. That's when you're talking Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, as well as speaking on Sunday. That if someone comes in here and I've met them through the week, that they don't hear me, you know, it even has something to do with, sometimes I hear, you know, pastors talking like this, and then they come into the pulpit and then their voice changes, and then they, oh Lord, you know, and it's like, whoa, what? That guy was over here talking like this, and then now he's all sudden, and like, what happened there? So the conversation, more than just the sound or the tone of it, it should be the same individual. It should be the same person, the same type of speech at home, in the community, as in the church. It all goes together. You can't just say, you know, and this sadly, there are preachers who are thinking they need to become a little more shocking. They need to use a little bit of off color and, you know, language to catch people, to relate to people so that the people can, no, I'm with you, you know, and I say bad words too, so you can relate to me and I can, no, what was that? That's not biblical. Be an example. people are going to follow, then you better set the course and it better be straight. Set an example in your word, in conduct. So again, live above reproach in your manner of life. It's not just for the preacher, I remind you. Paul instructed all, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Timothy's in Ephesus. Well, Paul instructed all of the Ephesians about their conduct, their manner of life. See, the point is this, if the church leadership, they set the example, then the church membership, the church body should follow. And if the church leadership is setting a poor example, an unbiblical example, then what's going to happen to the flock? If the shepherd can't find water, how are the sheep going to find water? Okay? So it all goes together. This is all together. And Paul writes in Ephesians 4, 22, 23, and 24, he says, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. That's what believers, that's what we do. When you come to the Word, when you are in times of prayer, that's what we're doing. We're putting off the old man and we're putting on the new. So God has changed us internally through the gospel, and then we are engaged in this process. That's why we engage in Bible studies together, because we are actively not just saying, here I am, Lord, if you want to do it, then do it. No, you are doing it, and I want to be part of what you're doing, so I want to see how the gospel changes me. I'm part of this. I'm joining with you in this work, knowing if it ever gets done, it's you, and I want what you want. So here I am. Use the scalpel on me. Cut away the sin so that there's cleansing and purity and growth in me. Put off the old man, put on the new. He says you have to be an example in love. In love, self-sacrificing on behalf of another, on behalf of others, regardless of how a person feels. Think about this. You have to love. You have to love the difficult person. You have to love the person that they don't make sense, speak lies. Timothy, you have to be an example of love. And love isn't you scratch my back, I scratch yours. Love is when they slap you on the one side, you turn the other cheek. And then after that, you deck them. No. How many times, Lord, are we supposed to forgive? Seven times. After how many? And once we've done that, we don't have to forgive them anymore? Come on, Peter. Once you've forgiven that many times, shouldn't you be in a habit now? Shouldn't you be in a pattern? Shouldn't you by then have understood this is how much the Lord has forgiven you, right? Okay? In love. It's not a love based on our feelings or emotions, but upon the love of God that was shed abroad in our hearts by Christ Jesus. Romans 5:5. Paul wrote of his love to the Corinthians, and his love, he contrasted with their love, 1 Corinthians 12:15. I want you to see that. Will you turn there? 2 Corinthians 12:15. Because I've mentioned this before, and as long as we are at home in this body, in this temple, this is a reality of life. And I also believe it to be true often for parents. In parenting, the more you do for your kids, and it can be grounded in love, the more it hurts them at times. And Paul says, as a shepherd, as a pastor, as a spiritual father over the Corinthians, he writes to them, 2 Corinthians 12:15, and I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. So there's no one in Corinth that would say, well, what, Paul, what are you talking about? You know, you came in the entourage, you had the nicest chariot and the armed guards and the, people fanning. No, that wasn't Paul. He came in fleeing for his life into Thessalonica. I mean, he traveled. This is the sight of Paul. I was like, are you kidding me? This guy? What happened to him, by the way? Because he looks like he got run over several times. Well, yeah, he actually has. By rocks. Oh. Yeah, he's an apostle. It's the message he comes. Not his frame. It's his message. That's where the power is. Paul says, you know it. I'll spend and be spent for you. I will die serving you. I will risk it all serving you. And then Paul highlights a problem. The problem is, though the more abundantly I love you, which that's what we're talking about here, Timothy, you have to love. This is God's kind of love. The more I love you, sadly, the less I am loved. The more I show you love, the more they took advantage of Paul. Well, you should do that. Make some more tents. Got medical bills? Do some more. The more I love you, the less I'm loved. Isn't that sad? Wouldn't you feel a stinging something if you were in that Corinthian church where this is true? Paul is writing this by the Spirit of God. He's not lying. The more I love you with my life, the less you love me back. How sad is that? In love, be an example. In word, in conduct, in love, in spirit. That's not included in better manuscripts, but it's true. In spirit, it wasn't just going through the motions. In faith, unswerving commitment or faithfulness. 1 Corinthians 4:2, moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful. Oh, I pray that we would be a people that would say, God, make me faithful. I want to be faithful. Just let me be faithful. Faithful to you, faithful to my family, faithful to my calling, faithful to the church, and in purity. And here Paul is referring primarily to sexual purity. Timothy, you're a young man, you're a single man, you have to be pure, both in your actions and in the intentions of your heart. You have to be pure. 1 Corinthians 4:14, therefore I urge you, imitate me. So that's what Paul is saying to Timothy, imitate me. You have to set an example, Timothy. Be an example. Number two, maintain a thoroughly biblical ministry. And we see this in verse 13. Maintain a thoroughly biblical ministry. This is the primary purpose for the gathering of the church. That's why this piece of wood right here, this pulpit, central figure, this is where the Word of God rests. So the church is under the Word of God. I stand behind, you know, or sit. It doesn't matter if you stand or sit. But this is the primary thing in our church. This furniture is the primary piece of furniture in this church, not an altar. It's the Word of God has spoken. God has spoken to us. And we need to hear it for the purpose of obeying it, of heeding the Word of God. Not just hearing it, not just in one ear and out the other. But to hear it, to come under it, to embrace it, to apply it, to live it out. Maintain a thoroughly biblical ministry. Give attention to is a phrase that encompasses not just the act of teaching, but also all of the private work, study, and prayer that goes into delivering a message or sermon. So Paul says, I want you to give attention to. Give attention to what, Paul? To the public reading of Scripture. Declare the truth in such a way that it is recognized as a high priority in the church. Do you realize? That's why every week, somewhere at the beginning of the service, someone stands, opens the Word of God, and we read Scripture. Well, why do we do that? Because we're commanded to. The Bible says, give yourself. Pay attention to the public reading of Scripture. That the people stop, pause, time out, that we hold people. That's a good time to not be coming in. Hold outside. If you didn't make it in by the first song, wait. Because God's Word is being read. We teach our children, which it takes them a while sometimes to find their spot in the Bible. You know, when we're going to Psalms, I remember Lola used to do that. We'd be halfway, almost finished with the Psalm, and she's still flipping the pages down on the front row. I'm like, all right, all right. Why? We're teaching them. This is the Word of God. Listen to the Word of God. Understand the Word of God. But not just that, then you have the exhortation. Give attention to the public reading of Scripture and give our attention to exhortation. Paraklesis is the Greek word. It's to encourage people to apply the truth and enjoy the blessings. So we just don't come and hear the Word and this is the Word of the Lord and we leave. Now what does it mean? What is God saying? Who is that written to? How did they apply that? What were they supposed to do? Okay, then cross that ribbon, then bring it into, now how do I apply that into my life? What does that mean? How does that apply to me? How do I obey that? Exhortation, comfort, and consolation that is found in the Word. The Word cuts and the Word heals like a surgeon's scalpel. Do you know how C.H. Spurgeon was saved? He was caught in a snowstorm, and he wandered into a small Methodist church. The pastor didn't even make it that night. One of the church leaders, a deacon, I believe, got up from Isaiah, preached, "Look and live," didn't know what else to say. So his message was, "Look and live. Look and live, my brothers. Look and live. Young man in the back, look to Christ and live." The scales dropped off his eyes. He came to faith in Christ and was never the same. Through an exhortation from, here's the word of God, this is what it means, obey. And that man was saved. It's the power in the word, not in the person standing here. Don't ever forget that. And then also doctrine, that is teaching. Week after week of imparting the truth of God's word to his people. See, the good minister is like a bricklayer in his approach to the Word of God. That's why we go through it systematically. We go book by book, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. And I'm pretty stubborn and I stay pretty much on the Word of God, even when holiday seasons come for the most part. Why? Because the Word of God and the teaching of God for the people of God is really transcendent. It's more important than a calendar. So we stick to the Word of God to build complete thoughts so that the people of God know whole books. They know whole context. They know whole passages. They can understand the Word of God. For what purpose? To now you can go tell people I know more? Uh-uh. No way. For you to apply it and teach your families. For you to apply it and teach your neighbors. For you to apply it and share the truth with others so that you're strengthened. You know what you believe. You've gained some spiritual legs under you. You can stand on the word of God and you can deliver those around you. Isaiah 28 verse 10, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little. So God uses his workmen to come in, and when I came 10 years ago, what handed to me? The trowel, the mortar, and the bricks. And we just lay 1 week after the next. And there are weeks when, all right, Scott, here you go. All right, Jamie, here you go. And what are we doing? We're building, we're laying a foundation of Scripture so that you understand the Word of God and you see it. And you get it. And we obey it. Give attention to this. Number three, fulfill your calling, verse 14. Fulfill your calling. Paul writes, do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. So here you have an apostle. There's an element here of the Lord working through the apostle and knowing, Timothy, this calling of God on your life. And here, this is an exhortation saying, Timothy, you need to live in a single-minded way to develop the gift that was given to you for ministry. Ministry does not happen in a vacuum, Timothy. The Holy Spirit gifted you, Timothy, for the service to the church. And Paul's reminder implies that Timothy may have been neglecting his gift. He may have been holding back. He may have been hiding out in the study a little bit too often because there's some loudmouths in the church that are older than he is and he doesn't know what to do with them. And they're really influential. And they think this young punk who's greenhorn, they need to instruct him on, now listen here, this is Ephesus. And you're not no Apostle Paul, buddy, so you better listen to us. And Paul is writing to Timothy in the presence of the congregation. Timothy, you do know what you're supposed to do, so don't back down. Your life cannot cancel your message, okay? You can't have people in the church saying, well, I would listen to you, but you remember that joke you told the other night? Okay, I'm not listening to you because you're filthy. Remember this, that, the next thing? So you have to remove all of the stones that people can throw at you because they're going to come at you when you deliver the truth. So don't hand them stones. Here you go. Later on, you're going to need this, and you can throw them at me. No, don't do that. Live a life that's an example so that people are left with, we don't have any accusations against Jesus, so get some scoundrels and let them go lie. Okay, he claims to be God. Crucify him. Paul said, I find no, or Pilate, I find no fault in him. Crucify him. Okay? That's our example. Do you think on that in that way at your job? That if suddenly you start sharing the gospel, people are like, whoa. What? Who is this? Gospel. What? Remember what you were saying? Remember when the hammer hit your hand? I'm not listening to you. What are you talking? Remember when the boss said you weren't doing a good job, or they said you need to pick it up a little or whatever? Remember how you reacted to that? Now you're preaching to me? You see how that conflicts? So what are you going to do? If you're that way in lifestyle, you're not going to talk to people about the gospel. Because you know they're going to say, please, I'm listening to you. Timothy, fulfill your calling. Get to it. You're set apart. You ordained a ministry. The hands, the eldership. You see that? The multiplicity of elders in the church. Remember that? The hands laid on you. Remember the weight? The weight of ministry placed on you? Scott is finishing his degree this week. He's finishing seminary. And the time will come. And we're going to celebrate, I think it's January 8th. As a church family, we're going to come together. We're going to rejoice in God's faithfulness and Scott's fortitude and his family that he's finished this chapter of his life. He's almost there. He's got two more days. He's going to finish. And we will rejoice with him. And we will say, praise God. And we love you. And now what is next? We don't know. But God knows. And we're going to evaluate, when is that day when we come together and we ordain him to ministry and he feels this and the weight is placed upon him, just like Timothy and Paul is saying, hey, no, you don't let this go to waste. You don't waste 6 months and a year and a decade. You get to it and you use this gift because there's people who need your gift. It's not about you, Timothy. It's about the people who need the gift of the Holy Spirit that was borrowed to you, entrusted to you, that you will give account to. One day. That word for eldership, you probably know the Greek word, Presbyterian. That's the word. There's a multiplicity of elders leading in the church. It was the ruling council of the Jews, and it is to be the ruling body in the local church. Eldership. Number four, give yourself entirely to ministry. Verse 15, we see this. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them. Timothy, there's no holding back as you become totally absorbed into your work. A pastor is constantly thinking of and praying for those under his oversight in ministry. There's no room for double-mindedness. Here we see the idea of the shepherd, the literal shepherd. He cares for his sheep. He's with his sheep. He smells like the sheep. He protects his sheep. He leads them. He guides them. He feeds them. He loves them. He develops them. He disciplines the erring ones that run away, and he brings them back. He protects them from danger. The shepherd is to shepherd his family. They must be properly cared for in the light of this instruction. And then, Timothy, you have to give yourself entirely to the ministry. You've got to shepherd the flock of God, as Peter wrote in 1 Peter 5. Shepherd the flock of God who is among you. You have to serve in that way. Number five, progress in the gospel ministry. You see this at the end of verse 15. You're going to progress in these things. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them. Why? That your progress may be evident to all. Meditate on these things. Give yourself. So you give yourself entirely to ministry, the private development, the alone time with God, with your family, and then out into the public. It's all ministry. And progress in the gospel ministry. As you grow in these things, and make progress, your maturity and fruitfulness will be evident to all. So here Paul anticipates and expects Timothy to advance in his usefulness. Paul knew that as Timothy grew and matured as a man of God, the congregation would recognize his development. If a man does not progress, if he doesn't grow, if he doesn't mature, if the congregation is not increasingly noticed the grace of God, maturing God's servant, then perhaps this man needs to do a serious evaluation. That he's not growing. If I'm the same individual in development now as when I came here, that'd be a problem. It'd be a real problem. It surprised me when I heard in John Piper say in a message that every year, and I think he was at Bethlehem Baptist Church there in Minneapolis for almost 40 years, and he said, every year I evaluate. Is this the place where God, you want me, that I'm most effective in your hand for your kingdom? It's not about me. It's not about this particular local church at this point. It is your kingdom, your name, your glory. Is this where you want me? Is this where my one life is most effective? 39 years later, he served faithfully. Number 6, persevere to the end. Persevere to the end. Verse 16, finish strong in faithfulness. What are the areas that the servant of God, elders, pastors, leaders, believers, what must we pay attention to? Take heed to yourself. That's where it always begins. Okay, it's really easy to start going after other people. Well, you know, if so-and-so, it's so easy to do that. Take heed to yourself. Timothy, start with you. You know, look in the mirror. Let God work there. Start there. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine, to the teaching. Continue in them. This isn't something like, I did that. You know, back in 2015, I went through that how people change thing. I'm done with that. I graduated. Yeah, really? No. Continue in them. We're going to need this for the duration, folks. We're going to need this for the long term, for the long haul. Is the gospel working in us? Take heed to yourself and take heed to your doctrine. When must the man of God do these things? Always. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Continue in them. Therefore, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Always abounding. Always, 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 always. What did Paul say? 3:14, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Run your race. Paul ran his race. Timothy ran his race. Are you running your race? Or are you sitting on the side, evaluating and critiquing everybody else running the race? Now, you know, if I was serving in that nursery, I would do, really? Right? No, come on. Are you running your race? Well, you know, I'm retired now, Pastor. No, you're still alive. Check this. Beating? You're not retired from ministry, from serving. That doesn't ever happen. Don't do this. Don't take your rest now. Rest comes when your heart stops or Christ returns and he says, enter into your rest. Don't steal from that rest. Say, actually, Lord, I'm going to take it now. I'm going to buy the American dream and I'm going to rest now. No. You have one life. I have one life. Fulfill your ministry. Persevere to the end. What does he say? Run through the tape. What's the tape? Death or Christ's return? Okay? As you get older and you mature in the gospel, in the word, you should be picking your knees up spiritually. You say, I can't even lift my knees anymore. We're not talking physically. Outwardly, the man is wasting away. Inwardly, I'm being renewed day by day. That you are running through the tape, that you are anticipating the return. You're about to see Christ in the next, what, decade? 2 decades? Are you anticipating that? Are you ready for that? Are you longing for that? Do people around you feel that? This isn't a jihad. I want to die. That's what I want to do. I'm going to die. No, he's let you live for a reason, to share the love, the gospel, live for Christ. Why would you do this? Why must the man of God always remain faithful? Because Paul says, for in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Okay, that sounds like a problem to me. Wait a second. I thought it was by grace you've been saved through faith. And now Paul says to Timothy, you'll save yourself. Is that a contradiction? What's Paul talking about here? What is he on about here? Well, salvation is the work of God. But it is his pleasure and it is his sovereign plan to bring the gospel through men to other people. So in doing this, you will save yourself. False teachers are unregenerate and lost. They aren't saved themselves. Then they bring a man-centered, false righteousness message and they entrap people and they damn those people with that unsaving, no hope message, empty message. So they aren't saved and the people that follow them through mindless religious routines are not saved either. That's a problem. Timothy, you will evidence that you have been saved by being faithful to these things, taking heed to yourself and to the doctrine, continuing. You will persevere, and in doing so, you save yourself. You evidence that you have been saved, and that message alone that saves will be useful in your mouth and in your life to save others. For there is only one name that saves. This means that as we faithfully live and proclaim the gospel, we will give evidence that our own conversion is genuine, and we will provide for our hearers the only possible message that brings salvation. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The false teacher, that is so difficult. Let's try this. And people who are carnally minded, yeah, that was so much more fun. We had more fun. Church was fun. That was so fun. Yeah, but what if it leaves your soul in hell? How much fun is that? Not so fun. Yeah, because Christ came for joy to the world. The Lord is coming, is come. Oh, this is happiness. This is blessed to know God and to be delivered from sin. So the good minister, did you get the six characteristics? Be a good example. Maintain a thoroughly biblical ministry. Fulfill your calling. Give attention. Give yourself entirely to ministry. Progress in the gospel ministry and persevere to the end. Perhaps you've known someone that's made a profession of faith and then they've made a hash of it. Couldn't tell them as a Christian now for, you don't know what happened. It's heartbreaking. And to the degree that people followed them and their influence, the hurt, the shrapnel, the effect, the outworking of that is even more devastating because of the people that followed them. Possibly you know of someone who once served the Lord in the gospel ministry and now they've fallen away like Judas. There's deep hurt there. So can I invite you, pray for your leaders. Pray for the leaders in the congregation, and not just our congregation, but other congregations. Oh God, may those men be faithful to you. Pray these six things over them. Can I ask you to consider, prayerfully consider God's calling in your life? Let this book, let this letter work in you. Will you pray that over the young men in this church? God, will you let young men, will you call them? Call them to step up and say, I will give my life to serve the Lord. And may they persevere to the end. Make your calling and election sure. The only way you can persevere to the end is if you've been born again. Is if you've repented of your sin and you've trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you done that? Do you know Christ? Come and worship. Come and worship. The only way to receive the salvation that God freely offers is through repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus. So if you haven't done that yet, I'm inviting you today, come and worship the King that was born to die for you, to give you life, to forgive your sins. Surrender to Him today, right now. How do I do that, Pastor? You admit, I'm a sinner. I deserve hell. I trust in the Lord Jesus. I believe in my God, in my heart that God has raised Him from the dead. He lived a sinless life. He died. He died for me. I trust in Him. Lord, save me. Rescue me. Here I am. I surrender all. I will live for You. Will you trust in Him today? Let's stand together. Father, I thank You for Your word, and I thank You for the power of the Spirit. And I pray that as the gospel has gone out today, that it will register, it will hit in our hearts and in our lives, and it will change us for Your glory, for Your name's sake. You know every person who is here today, and I pray that we would all yield to Your Spirit, that we would come and worship You, for You alone are worthy. In Jesus' name and for His sake, amen.